Northeast Tonight, brought to you by Oil India Limited, conquering newer horizons.
Welcome to Northeast Tonight, the show that decodes the region. Is there a work culture in Assam and the rest of the Northeast? And if so, what is it? Is it a work culture where everything is taken casually? If our work culture is poor or average compared to the rest of the country, who is responsible? We as a region or as a people seem to be perennially busy or engaged in three major things. Holidaying, festivities, and agitating or in agitations. Most common events circle around festivals or festivities, songs, dance, music. We have nothing against songs, dance, music. And if there is a break, then the government gets busy tackling agitations. On their part, the agitationists get busy trying to devise new ways to sustain their movements by trying to draw the attention or stir the imagination of the masses. For the record, this year, that is 2020, the Assam government has declared a total of 36 holidays to mark 30 different occasions. Besides, there are 30 restricted holidays for another 30 different occasions. To discuss about the typical work culture of the region or the lack of it and its most populous state in Assam, for example, from Imphal, I am being joined by Professor Jalajit, K. Jalajit, head of the Department of Economics at the Manipur University. Guwahati University Professor Dr. Akhil Ranjan Datta is also with me. And here in our studios, I have with me Professor Gautam Barua, Director of the Indian Institute of Information Technology, Guwahati. Mr. R.S. Joshi, industry expert, former head of FINA, and Professor Prasenjit Biswas from the Northeastern Hill University. Gentlemen, welcome to the program. I'm coming to you straight, Mr. Jalajit, Dr. Jalajit from Manipur University, head of the Department of Economics. Professor Jalajit, how will you define the work culture of the Northeastern region?
For me, the work culture in the Northeast seems to be a lack of professionalism. There is no lack of talent or no lack of people willing to work, but nonetheless, the atmosphere in the offices seems to be not that conducive. There seems to be like most of them coming for a routine kind of day-to-day affairs, and nothing much to really look forward to, not much vision or no big objective being set forward. So in effect, I will sort of say that there seems to be lack of professionalism towards work. In fact, another thing I would like to add is basically there seems to be very little respect about times of others. So I think
lack of professionalism, and people are casual about punctuality and casual about time factor. Dr. Akhil Ranjan Datta, do you have a contrary view? Is it as pessimistic as what Professor Jalajit from Manipur University is saying, or what do you have to say? How do you view it? What is it, the work culture, if I ask you, how do you define that?
No, I don't have that much of disagreement what professor from Manipur University has said. I do believe that we do not have a very healthy work culture here, but there are factors behind it. And you have, in the very beginning, you have mentioned a few very important issues. But apart from those issues, we also need to look at the kind of economy that we have and the kind of aspirations that people have. We are living in a subsistent economy where accumulation is not the driving force. We want to live, we want to move on without being driven by a lot of aspirations or driven by the sense of accumulation at the economic level. And that lack of sense of accumulation has also impact on all these, on the overall world culture in the region.
Okay. Now, Professor Gautam Barua, you had been the founder director of the Indian Institute of Technology, by far the most prominent institution of excellence and higher learning in the entire Northeastern region. And today, you are also heading as the director of another very, very premier institute, that is the Indian Institute of Information Technology. You have been interacting with some of the best brains in the country, young minds, bright young minds. But you know, when we talk about the work culture in the Northeastern region, why is it like that? Is it because we don't have a competitive culture here? There is lack of competition? What is it? Why do you think the work culture is not up to the mark compared to the rest of the country? Why are people so casual?
Yeah, I think, you know, what Okhil has said about the economy, I think has a role to play. For example, there are very few corporations in, say, Guwahati. So if there were corporations as they are in big cities, they drive the work culture. They insist on time management. They insist on the employees coming at a particular time and leaving at a particular time. And this creates an atmosphere where everybody has to work according to those norms. The buses will start at that time. The trains will be running.
Yeah.
And so on and so forth. Whereas here, it's dominated by, you know, service sector, which has got its own timings. It is dominated by the government, which succumbs to, you know, not doing enough work at the right time. And so I think it is mainly to do with the economic surroundings. The same person from here who goes to Bangalore, you see the time, kind of timings he or she keeps.
Will maintain. Okay, R.S. Joshi, you had been with Finer, you are an industry expert yourself. Is it the economic ecosystem around the people, you know, that leads to this kind of a average work culture, if I may? See, while doing this debate, let me tell you, we are not generalizing. We are just generally discussing the work culture that could have been much, much better, much, much proficient than what it is today. And there are people who are extremely, extremely hardworking. Let me put this on record. This is not a generalized debate. We are not generalizing the people in the Northeastern region as people who are casual and not interested in working. That's not the purpose. So having said that, R.S. Joshi, is it the economic ecosystem where there is hardly any competition, where is hardly any industrialization and avenues where that is leading people to lead a very, very casual kind of a life?
See, easy going in the region is one of the factor for not having the healthy work culture. Another thing, see, one set of people, they are highly committed and have all the respect for healthy work culture. On the other hand, good section of people, see, they are brought up in such an environment, the day they are born, they must be feeling the bandh culture and so many other things. So, see, that has its bearing on their upbringing, and they just, other like bandh culture is flourishing in the region, not the work culture. So, not wrong with the people, from the leadership top down the line, see, everywhere we terribly missing the healthy work culture in the region.
Okay. Now, Dr. Prasenjit Biswas, for example, take the case of Assam. We have 36 holidays to mark 30 different occasions this year, that is 2020. Besides, there are 30 restricted holidays also to mark another 30 different occasions. Now, what does it reflect? What are your opening thoughts?
Yeah, the loss of work days is something like a major concern, but we have to think about how we define work, in what sense we are defining work. Work could be a kind of a creative work as well. It's not merely competitive. And work also has to be rewarding. If there is an absence of reward, even after very, very hard work from day, morning to the evening, as it happens in the case of a large part of rural masses, and as you know, large part of rural masses are indebted. Even if they work, the cycle of debt and the work create a vicious situation for them in which they remain caught. So markets have to be developed in a manner that markets can capitalize the labor, which is not yet able to do. And we still have a lot of surplus labor. In a lot of areas, there are a lot of industries need to be built up. Unless that kind of a groundwork is done, it is not possible to really create a conducive atmosphere for good work.
So you are saying that you are saying
ground level in Assam.
You are saying that efficient and proper work culture is market driven.
Market in the sense of coordinating a large mechanism of productive activity, and also whatever is produced out there, that has to have some takers in the larger market. Now, in both cases, it is not happening. The market that we have is a backwardly bent market of the mainstream India in the entire Northeast. Market doesn't develop from here, it comes from elsewhere. So that remains as a major bottleneck for the entire region.
So, Dr. Jalajit, is it, you have heard Dr. Prasenjit Biswas saying that, you know, the market doesn't actually, there is no market activity here. It comes from outside. It's not a manufacturing hub. There are hardly any industrialization. Whatever market-based activities, it's based on products which are produced elsewhere, which come here. How do you look at it? Is it one of the reasons?
Basically, when we are looking at the work culture, we may look at the work cultures in various, say, industrial units. We may look at the work culture in various government offices. We can look at any place, a marketplace, retailers. So basically, the structure, the guidelines, which from the top, how that organization has to be run over, has to be well-defined. And if the employees sort of stick to the guidelines on their own, instead of with some kind of discipline, in that case, some positive kind of work culture will develop. So it is basically loyalty towards the organization for which you are working, and sort of feeling that the objective or the goal of that larger goal of that organization for which you are working should be met with your effort.
Right.
Without now, anyone sort of monitoring.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Now, Dr. Akhil, I'm coming to you, Professor Gautam Barua, but Dr. Akhil Ranjan Datta, you know, generally the Northeast is described in three ways. It's a place where there are a lot of festivities, nothing wrong in that. This is a place where there are a lot of holidays. Of course, it is linked to festivals. And of course, this is a region where there is a plethora of hesitations at any given point of time. The region, at least some part of it, some part or the other, is in an full-blown agitation mode. So why has these three things become the characteristic feature of this region?
Yeah. Before that, let me tell you, elaborate the very notion of work culture. Now, what are the parameters of work culture? And do we have, for example, do we have a universal parameters of work culture? That has to be understood in the very beginning. In the context of the Northeastern region, it has its own parameters of work culture. Work culture doesn't necessarily mean working in the offices. You know, work culture doesn't mean being very hard and fast to the time. It's because of the given economy, because of the way of life of the people, because of the very sense of livelihood, sources of livelihood, so on and so forth. That needs to be kept in mind. We are still in the process of transition. Transition to, you know, match up with the quote-unquote given work culture, which is considered to be very universal. This is the very first thing. I'm coming to your question. The ethno-cultural setting, we have a competitive ethno-cultural self-determination-driven culture here. This has nothing to do with the economy edges. This has nothing to do with accumulation. We have been pushed into a situation where we think in terms of self-determination. Self-determination is being defined in terms of the particular ethnicity, and that particular ethnicity becomes the reference point, and agitation has emerged as the rallying point of realizing that, that self-determination. Here, agitation is the work culture. You compete to get political mileage through agitation, and that agitation has become the, you know, setting of or the parameter of work culture here. So this is very, very critical. This is very, very critical, and we need to question it. We need to investigate into very comprehensively.
Okay. Now, Professor Gautam Barua, you know, is it as simple as what we are discussing, or there are certain parameters? How do you gaze? How do you say that people in a certain region have a different, better work culture or than people in the northeastern region? How do you compare? What are some of the parameters? What are some of the indicators?
In the classical sense, you know, you will have to look at productivity of labor. You know, when someone does some work, what is the value addition to the economy that is being given per capita? And that definitely is low in our region. So, however, you know, I think we have to change also the environment, the way we think. As you mentioned about the holidays, I mean, the government clearly needs to reduce the number of holidays. Unfortunately, as has been mentioned, there are so many ethnic communities, everybody wants their particular holiday to be declared.
Yeah.
Maybe it is time to say that nobody's holiday will be declared a holiday. You know, let's not have holidays. Let's remember the person or persons that we ought to remember, but without going for a holiday. I think depends a lot on the government to create this thing. The other thing is, you see, I want to say that the work culture, as I mentioned about, you know, there is an environment. There are certain pockets where there is work culture, but those are actually inside campuses. So in Guwahati itself, we have the refinery. Now the refinery, there is definitely work culture. They follow routines and everybody has to, you know, follow that. But most of the employees stay inside the campus. You know? So the city does not see the shift changing and people moving around in the buses.
Same is the case with the tea gardens, isn't it?
Similarly in the tea gardens. Hmm. Similarly, I was going to say, you know, in IIT, in a campus, the work culture there is very different from other institutions where it's in the city.
All right. Now, I'm coming to you, Mr. Arasosi, but Dr. Prasenjit Biswas, no. You know, I think Dr. Akhil Ranjan Datta was talking about, you know, the diversity being one of the, perhaps one of the reasons. Since we have a plethora of ethnic groups in the entire Northeastern region, 400 groups and subgroups combined together. Everybody has their religions, religious festivals and other festivals. And everyone wants that those should be declared a holiday so as to recognize their uniqueness. So do you think diversity is also one of the reasons why we have so many holidays and why we have so many festivals and we can do nothing about it?
Being a very, very multicultural, multi-religious kind of a setting in the Northeast, diversity creates a kind of a market for itself. The cultural diversity itself generates a lot of demand in the market. Therefore, these festivities that happen, they are participated by a large number of public. That brings together a large number of producers as well. Now, how we turn these festivities into an economically surplus-generating occasion is a work that we need to do at the policy level. Apart from this, we need to also look at the traditional work culture. The work culture in Arunachal Pradesh among Apatanis or the work culture among Khasis are to be emulated. That work culture is not emulated. Work culture that is available culturally needs to be emulated, strengthened and consolidated. Instead of it, what is being talked about more and more is about a more advanced post-industrial kind of work culture, which if it comes in certain pockets is well and good, but it may not be having a widespread given that we are largely still an agrarian.
It's too much to expect.
Yeah, too much.
Absolutely. So, Mr. R.S. Joshi, you know, as Dr. Prasenjit Biswas was saying, how do we convert festivities circling, whether it is a festival, whether we see a trend where everything that the government organizes is also some kind of festivals, you know, that is the government, not apart from the festivals which are marked on the calendar involving communities, there are festivals created by the government. This is a trend in the Northeastern region. Now, how do we convert these festivals into market or business opportunities?
See, to start with, there is nothing wrong with the festivity and good things. It should result in more productivity rather. But I sincerely feel time has come. We must have mission, vision and value statement for our leadership first to start with. See, it's there the people who are setting the example. And down the line, we just see without having the talent, without having the requisite qualification, without having that kind of things, people can be at top without toiling like that thing. So we need to set example at the top, then people down the line will follow the leadership. Unfortunately, we haven't have that kind of leadership. Nothing wrong with people. Our very own people, they are doing exceedingly okay. well outside the region.
Right.
So that we need to encase upon our
talent. As Dr. Jalajit says in the beginning, Dr. Professor Jalajit said in the beginning that, you know, we lack professionalism, but we do not lack talent. So that is what you were saying, Mr. Joshi, that our people are doing so well outside, why not within the region? Dr. Akhilranjan Datta, you know, you see, whenever there is a festival, we see lot of migrant workers going out. Same is the case in Manipur. Do you think that the work culture we are lacking because we are leaving too many things to be done by the migrant workers and the labor is cheap? Is it one of the reasons because we are an agricultural economy, but most of our agricultural land is being tilled today by migrant workers? This is also leading to settlement of large number of migrant workers in areas like Bodo, Bodoland, where the Bodo tribes people, or for that matter, other tribes people have started working less and less on their agricultural fields. So is this a cause for worry? Is it also a reflection of our work culture, the transformation in our work culture?
See, I think this situation is more complex than we perceive. For example, I come from a very remote area, Dhemaji and Lakhimpur district. You know, it's happening. Lot of our youths are migrating to the southern region, southern metropolis of the country. And they are working very hard in those cities. As a result of it, there have been huge migration of the migrant laborers to my, you know, districts and villages and to the region also. But apart from that, we need to understand that there is a transition in the whole perception of the communities. There's a transition. They have been thinking in terms of transiting from the agriculture to certain other levels. But you do not have the opportunities. You do not have the farm sectors. You do not have the non-farm sectors. You do not have the industries. You do not have enough opportunities in the service sector. As a result of it, in the process of the transition, lot of things are happening. And the political leadership has not been very, very sincere in terms of bringing that transformation.
No, Doctor,
providing any kind of opportunities to.
Right. Dr. Jalajit, please. What is your experience? Because so many, there's a huge population in a small area like the Imphal Valley. Let's not talk about the hill districts in Manipur, which has a wide area but very little people. But the entire concentration is on the small strip of land, that is the Imphal Valley. My question is, what has been your experience? Still, there is a lot of migrant workers who are flocking to Manipur, who are working in Manipur. That is forced your government and the people to even demand inner land permit, which you have recently got.
from the work culture point of view, another aspect of Manipur is that in a plain area, the society is so close-knitted, everyone seems to be knowing each other, and hence there are lots of social events wherein each and everyone is sort of being invited. So in fact, those social events happen during daytime and all, during office hours, during working hours. So in fact, these employees, they tend to sort of leave their offices and attend those social events. So in fact, of course, that trend
during office hours, during office hours, you're saying,
So at times, of course, now people sort of reach to those as hosts in the morning time and say that I got this kind of engagement, so I will not be able to come and attend that kind of ceremony.
Yeah.
So that trend seems to be catching up, but nonetheless, that needs to be rectified.
Needs to be rectified. But that brings me to the question, Professor Gautam Barua. How do you instill work culture?
I just add one more thing. Yeah.
Please add.
Yeah. In fact, Professor Prasenjit was talking about productivity. So in fact, we have to be very sort of mindful about the productive time which the workers or the employees is able to give during their office hour. It's not with that they come early and sort of leaving at late hour and without sort of producing any kind of value-added work during their stay. So that also, and that will come out of their commitment to the organization. Maybe the organization also will have to sort of see that their employees are well equipped with the skills to perform the work.
Absolutely.
So, in between, there should be various trainings, various organizations, and maybe,
Now, Professor Gautam Barua, when we said, oh, work culture needs to be instilled, you know, we have to improve our work culture, can anybody do that? Is it something not ingrained? Is it the ecosystem around you that dictates how you behave when you are working? Can anybody instill work culture?
Yeah, we got to change the way things are, basically. And we obviously, you know, the government has a role to play. Let's come back to this holiday issue. You know, you'll notice that in Holi, Phakwa, now there are some places Phakwa is on day one, some places Phakwa is on day two. But in Assam, you'll find invariably it's both day one and day two. Right? When you have a Magh Bihu, the holiday starts off with only one day, maybe 2 days by the government, invariably a third day is added. The puja holidays stretch on, and you talk about migration, the culture of migrating back to the village for the holiday, I'm not talking about migrants from outside. The worker who has come from Dhemaji, in Bihu has to go home, right? Now, if he has to go home, he's going to take 6 hours, one, you know, to go, he's going to cut the afternoon of the day before, then next day he will come after lunch. And so we have to tell people, no, you can't do this.
Right.
You know?
Right, but at the end of the day, Prasenjit Biswas, is it lack of industrialization, lack of opportunities, lack of enough livelihood options that is forcing people to take everything casually? Is there a sense of despondency in the entire Northeastern region?
If you follow Abhijit Banerjee and Esther Duflo's statement that India's economy is currently suffering because poor are not having money in their hands. We have to pump in more money in the hands of the poor. And if we look at the poverty situation in Assam, I think grossly 31% of the people can be considered as poor. That's a very high level of poverty estimation in the NSSO data. Now, given that situation, how do we generate income? And income generation will require creation of new opportunities of work. How many opportunities of work we are able to create is a major question, and it's a larger macroeconomic question. At a very, very micro level, individual entrepreneurship, individual initiatives are not rewarded. Many of the individuals who start in entrepreneurship is not able to move up much. Now, this is a situation of a strange blockade. Given that, festivities might open up certain a new corner for economy as it opens up in various parts of the South Asia. So therefore, festivities are not to be debunked. They should happen, but they should happen in an economic way so that there is an opportunity to earn something through these festivities as well.
Okay, festivities are not bad. Festivities have to be sort of transformed into economic opportunities. The challenge is how do you do that? We are in the middle of a very interesting conversation on the work culture and the Northeast region. Don't go away. I'll be right back after this very short break. Welcome back. Dr. Akhil Ranjan Datta, you know, agitations. Do you think agitations have also hit, repeatedly been hitting the markets, you know, in different parts of the Northeastern region? Take the case of Assam. The anti-CAA agitation, prior to that, it was the CAB, agitation against CAB. I mean, there are agitations galore. If you want to set up a dam, there will be an agitation against the dam. Can't there be a conversation, can't there be a dialogue between the government when you are proposing some big events and big developments? Take the case of Manipur. Dr. Jalajit is there. Even in an university, to change the vice-chancellor, about the actions of the vice-chancellor, there is 3 to 4 month long agitation. Everything is affected. Now, you know, why is it that the Northeast is hit by agitations almost round the clock throughout the year?
Yeah, apparently this is true that agitations are creating a lot of challenges towards the work culture. But that is only apparently true. People have been forced to go in for agitation. And we need to understand the political economy of agitation. One, we live in a society marked by a lot of contradictions. The contradictions is that there is scarcity and there is abundance of resources. And there is concentration of resources in the hands of a few. And there's huge marginalization, huge deprivation.
You are talking about distributive justice or the lack of distributive justice. But the point is, Okil Ranjan Datta, we don't see hesitations by student groups coming to the streets, demanding higher education facilities, demanding adequate jobs, demanding industries, demanding work culture. So these kind of agitations are missing. All agitations by student groups.
That is happening.
Where is it happening?
That is happening. It's happening. It's happening in a big way. You have not said, because the political issues are dominating us in such a way you do not see the visibility of these resources. You come to the university, students are seeking for. I teach students, hundreds of students every year, and they have been looking for it. They have been asking for it. You know, but then political situation is such that those issues do not go to the center of the political mobilizations. But what I'm trying to point out is this, there is also, you know, if you go to the private sector, for example, look at the private banks, the people who are working there, they have been working do and die situation, not necessarily the same people. The same youths are working there in a very desperate situation. Therefore, when you look at it, therefore I say that we have to study it very comprehensively.
Study it very critically. Okay, Dr. Jalajit, the same question goes to you. Is there enough hesitation for jobs? Is there enough hesitation for demanding institutes of higher learning? If you get on a plane from Imphal to Delhi, you will see hundreds of young boys and girls going for what? Not going for any technical courses, going to simply to pursue an undergraduate course, because there is not even enough proper undergraduate institutes and colleges in Imphal itself. There is lack of it, there is shortage. I mean, what's going on?
Basically, when you sort of said that lots of students seem to be going for just undergraduates or PG, but nonetheless, you will find that from Manipur, there's a hordes of students going out for technical educations, managements. So it's not just that they're just going for a general line. Of course, when you sort of said that, why so many students are flocking out looking for some higher education or higher technical degrees, there is basically because there is lack of enough good institutions in
that
our
state. That is the thing. That is the thing. That is the thing. R.S. Joshi. I'm coming back to you, Dr. Jalajit. R.S. Joshi, there is not only brain drain, it's also a flight of capital. When so many students are going, yes, Dr. Jalajit is right, some students are definitely going for technical courses, higher institutes of that requires, you know, education at higher institutes of learning, institutes of excellence, which are not available. But lots and lots, I think the majority of the students are going to pursue simple courses outside. That is not only leading to brain drain, it is also leading to a huge flight of capital from Manipur or, for that matter, other states in the Northeast.
It's very true. Mane, it's at a very large scale and we need to restrict it, check it and take remedial measures immediately. See, like one thing I would like to point out, the migrant labors you had earlier mentioned.
Yes.
This is a fact. I'm associated with one real estate project. And on the occasion of festivals, on the occasion of religious holidays like this, we are closed for 20, 25 days at a stage and
entire workforce.
So that is another way. See, we need to have new kind of format for protest. Protest is our democratic right, but we have to have in the new format. And we need to take note of development taking place elsewhere. And we need to keep pace with all these developments. Inclusive is one thing, and sir, that is very important. See, one set of people, they are rewarded, they are getting everything, but the other set of people, they are not getting. And lastly, one thing which is affecting the work culture is the corruption. Ultimately, some people think it is some people only, they are at the right place.
This question goes to both of you, Professor Gautam Barua and Dr. Prasenjit Biswas. First, Professor Gautam Barua, you know, do you think, you know, lack of adequate number of institutions of higher learning, specialized institutions in the Northeastern region? Of course, we have an IIT and now we have the IIIT, and luckily you have been associated with both. Now, question is, do you think this also plays a role in not in been inculcating this, you know, competitiveness among the local students?
You know, paradoxically, I think now we have reached a situation we have too many technical institutions. In fact, some of the private institutions, they're not able to fill up their seats, even in disciplines like electronics. The situation, in one technical institute in Guwahati closed down 2 years ago. Another one has stopped, closed down its EC discipline. So the lack of the students who are good, they are going outside. So it's a chicken and egg problem as always, you know. Unless the economy locally is strong, these institutions will not be strong. You can build one more IIT, you can build another NIT, but where are the faculty going to come from? Because we don't have that pool over here. So ultimately, it's the economy and it's also the mindset. Today, the children, their parents are telling them that you look for a government job. You know, this is the culture in a non-industrial area, yes. Traditionally in the East. It's a government job that we all want. And then, you know, very strangely, where the rest of the world, country, areas like computer science and electronics are number one. At one time, we found civil engineering was the most important one here because there were lots of jobs in the PWD and, you know, PHE and so on. So that work perception of that things can happen here, that we can do things on our own, entrepreneurship culture, that businesses can be started by young minds, the so-called startup culture is slowly coming in, but yeah. we have a lot to do to build that kind of confidence among our younger generation that they can themselves create work. And once they create work, then the work culture will automatically follow.
Prasenjit, how do you look at it?
No, there is an organic connection between the kind of entrepreneurship that the young people start and the relationship of this with the larger market, except the commodity market and the consumer market. In most cases, entrepreneurship doesn't succeed in the case of Northeast. Now, we require a lot of support for areas like horticulture, fishing, rearing of animals, and also agriculture and related trade. That is not happening. There is not much of a support system in those basic areas of economy. As far as service sector is concerned, Professor Barua is very right. The service sector is not really growing at a pace at which at the national level it is growing. Therefore, there is a slump in various areas of the economy, and there are a lot of gaps between one sector and another, and in these gaps, large number of young people are affected.
Okay. Now, Prasenjit, I'm coming to you, Dr. Akhilranjan Datta and Professor Jalajit. Now, Prasenjit, you know, the government, look at the case of the government. Government and our country is almost on an election mode as well throughout the year. Northeast is no exception. Now we are gearing up as far as Assam is concerned for the 21 elections we just had, and then the Bodo Council elections, so and so on. If we take one state, there is elections. Now, forget about that. Now, the question is, government most of the time are busy dealing with agitations, firefighting. That takes away a lot of their energy. You know, for the last 5 years, take the case of Assam. 50,000 plus students were busy in making the NRC. But you cannot help it because it's a government decision. You have to do it. There is no, we can't say that why are 50,000 people engaged in this. That's a different story, but that's a reality. No, that's not the question. Question is, I mean, you know, the government is most of the time entire resources, entire energy is focused in dealing or tackling with an agitation in hand.
That is because agitation is just a symptom of a deep underlying malaise that is there. And the malaise is largely this economic deprivation, lack of opportunity for income generation, and also expanding the livelihood capacities and upward mobility that should come with it. So therefore, it requires an economic revamping of the entire society, which requires a lot of policy planning, which requires starting with micro planning, planning our own resources, such as, let's say, water is a major resource that requires a lot of planning. There's absolutely no planning about water. There's absolutely no planning about forest. There's absolutely no planning about the agrarian fields that we
but
have.
But Professor Jalajit, where is the time for planning? The government has no time for advanced planning because the government is busy dealing with agitations after agitations. Take the case of Manipur. Give your own example.
Yeah, you may sort of said that there are too many protests, too many agitations, but nonetheless, on the government side, their work, etc., should be sort of going in their scheduled time, in their planned way. They should not get affected from this kind of basically agitations, like people with different conflicts, there are different conflicts in their interests, etc. There is bound to be some kind of agitations throughout, but nonetheless, that should not really affect how the governance of the state, basically in terms of planning, I think that should be the way about and
okay.
Basically
now,
it's about...
Okay, now Dr. Akhil Ranjan Datta, you see, you know, the government cannot turn a blind eye if there is a big agitation because at the end of the day, they have to get the votes, isn't it? They have to settle an agitation. They cannot allow an agitation to fester, and they cannot allow an agitation to mobilize the forces who are their potential rivals in the next election or an election in hand. Therefore, they have to tackle the agitations. In turn, they have to focus all their energies, channelize all their energies in dealing with such issues.
I think that is the tragedy. You know, government forces people to go on the street, and they spend their all resources in tackling the agitations. But we need to understand, and we have to be very, very clear on it. We are looking towards the agitations too much. Beyond agitations, you have millions of populations, millions of people who are working in the field, who are working at their own. Look at the small tea industries, tea growers here. They have been working there, but because of the wrong policies on the part of the government, the people who are producing the tea leaves are not getting their due. They are, you know, there has been huge depression there. Look at the producers of the vegetables. Go to Gwalpara, you will see that the production of tomato will cost around rupees 2 per kg, but when they come to the market, they have to sell it at rupees 50 paisa. So we need to look at, therefore I say that we need to study it very comprehensively. We need to study it very critically. At many instances, we are looking at very superficially. People on the ground probably are working very hard. They are struggling their life and livelihood. But because of, you know, not paying attention to those issues, we take it for granted that we do not have a work culture. I think therefore it is very important that we look at the economy very, very critically.
So when we talk about work culture, Mr. R.S. Joshi, at the end of the day, it is the market. It is the economy that has to be, you know, on a growth trajectory. Only then we can talk about work culture. Otherwise, we just shouting from the rooftops that we should have a better or proper work culture will not help. And my question also, what is a healthy work culture according to you?
So there are a number of factors that make a healthy work culture. The environment is one thing, rewarding the skill. And see, there is no alternative for hard work. That we need to understand in a very, very clear terms. See, the governments, like we in their manifesto, like they will be creating 50,000 jobs.
Yes.
Why in the government sector only? Why they don't create the enabling environment where a lot of opportunity for growth is there for the people? See, this right person at right job is also one of the factors.
Absolutely.
And see, probably we need to give thought of having some time zone also. See, it also affects when we compare our region with the rest of the country, then that also have some kind of bearing. So that we also need to, and the time has come, we need to define the work culture, the vision, mission and action, and have the productivity index. And then everybody is subject to that index, how fair I am doing, what I am doing to my region or here. So that fair assessment has to be done, and without any bias,
We have to.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, Professor Gautam Bora, what is the road ahead? Your concluding remarks.
I think that, you know, given the situation that we are in, I think that the government has a big role to play because a lot of the expenditure is government initiated. And there, my experience with interacting with the government over the years has been that there is a lot of scope for business process re-engineering.
Yeah.
Their decision making is very slow. Even today now, with so much of computerization coming in, I found that, you know, even when we computerize, the old file movement does not change. And when a file reaches the department, it goes from the dealing assistant to the undersecretary, to the deputy secretary, to the joint secretary, to the principal secretary, only for principal secretary to sign and send it all the way down by the same route. And all of this up and down takes 2 weeks.
So this whole idea of a paperless office is just an utopian dream.
So we must change it. So I think we should change. We need to change it.
Absolutely.
And the delivery of the benefits, the projects, the implementation of that has to become much more efficient.
Absolutely.
Today, the culture is that the government is doing a favor. If you go to the office, the thing is, what can I do for you? You know that if I do something for you, I'm doing you a favor. It's not that.
So that all these things have to change. Dr. Jalajit, your final comments.
Basically, what I find is there seems to be a mismatch between the level of educated persons and the kind of job to which they now have been sort of finally settled down, basically because they don't have any other option. So that mismatch, so in effect, it's not just about that degree which they have obtained or they have earned, which will sort of provide them a fitting kind of work or job. Basically, when the person realizes that he's a postgraduate and he lands up with a peon job, then obviously his mind and heart will not be into the job. He will just not perform that work well. So there is one thing, so that mismatch or that, and another is about respect for work of any kind from the society. So in effect,
so dignity. You're basically talking about the dignity of labor, works, respect for job of any kind that is missing among the local population. Yeah. That is something which you change. Okay, Ranjan Datta, your final comments. 10 seconds.
I think we have to come out of the kind of economy and kind of politics that we have been passing through. The economy that we have been doing, politics we have been doing, is basically beneficiary-driven politics and beneficiary. Government has been coming with competitive beneficiary schemes. Now, if we cannot move towards productive economy, where connecting with some productive work is being respected, I think we will not be in a position to come out of the kind of deficits that we have been witnessing in the work culture.
Absolutely correct. Now, last word to you, Dr. Prasenjit Biswas.
A bottom level kind of bottom up kind of synergy between cultural life and economic life has to be created. And that synergy has to be extended to the political institutions and political life of the people. Now, how that will be achieved, that will require a lot of creative thinking.
Okay, synergy needed between economic life and cultural life. There has to be a sync between economic activities and cultural activities. So how we can bring about this synergy, and apart from, of course, other things that the various panelists have pointed out, that will be the key in improving the work culture of the Northeastern region. As right at the beginning of this debate, Professor Jalajit from Manipur has said that there is lack of professionalism, although there is no dearth of talent. That is the bottom line. There is no dearth of talent. Only thing necessary is to channelize this talent into proper work culture. On that note, I end this edition of Northeast Tonight. I thank all my panelists for participating in this very engaging discussion and the viewers for watching the program. Good night and goodbye.
Northeast Tonight, brought to you by Oil India Limited, conquering newer horizons.